Welcome back to Board Game Bangers Campaign Pick of the Week. Except for one little issue, there is no pick this week. Now, the reason for that is normally when I look at Game Found and Kickstarter games every week, it's either a game that resonates with me, something that really fascinates me, or a game that, you know, I've backed and want to talk about. This week, none of those have actually happened. Look, RuneScape has just launched and that looks quite interesting, but it's not a game for me. So out of the games that I've actually launched this week, I'm going to talk about a game called Saray. Now, Saray is a game that has potential. The illustrations look fascinating. The mechanics actually are quite fresh and look really, really interesting. But the problem is the campaign page has multiple red flags. So look, let's go check out this campaign page and let's go see what's actually gone wrong with this campaign. So here we go, Saray by Nostromo Editions. 13,000 euros, about $14,000 US, and 192 backers. We're less than a day into the campaign, but unfortunately that first 24 hours is so important for any campaign to succeed. So why aren't people backing Saray? Now, the game itself is Egyptian themed. You're these sons and daughters, the Saray of the Pharaoh. Now you're trying to build your own little city up and trying to impress the Pharaoh so you can say, look, you are the best of the kids and you deserve to be the next Pharaoh. So look, great, great theme, love the idea of it, but there's issues at play. So the first issue is this is a French designer publisher. Now, nothing wrong with that, but the problem is all their review copies they sent out are also French reviewers. So the problem we have is you've now alienated a massive audience who don't, you know, can't get access to these videos because they obviously don't speak French. So, you know, first things first, need to send it out to English, German, you know, Spanish reviewers, whatever language, but you need to send out to a wide range of audience so you're going to get a wide range of eyes on your campaign page. So that's the first issue, but there's going to be multiple issues and we'll go through the campaign page and we'll just sort of have a chat about them as they come up. So first things first, 2 to 4 players lacking a solo mode. That's something, you know, in this sort of competitive day and age for board games, that's almost a must have nowadays. Here we go. I love the logo. The logo's really cool. Okay, now, game by Francois. So Francois, look, well done on this. I think the mechanics are really quite sound in this, and especially the main core mechanic, we're going to talk about this shortly, and it's actually really interesting. So here we go. This is the background. Pharaoh must decide which of his children will be worthy to rule the kingdom. Look, I like it. I like it. And again, love the art. Love a lot of things about this, and that's why I said this game has potential. Now, don't see your language above. Another red flag. When we get down to the rule book is in English, but it's pretty much like a Google Translate of a French rule book. So the rule book is so chunky, and it's really doesn't flow well. And it's even past that it's still in French. Just needed someone to look over that. And just little things like that. In this day and age, you know, you need this campaign page to be polished. Also missing a whole bunch of languages there. Again, spend the time, spend the money, get it in languages. Again, let people know about your amazing game. Now, how to play. Plays over 3 different phases. So the first one is you're going to be building a site or putting down a site, which is your potential build. And we're going to go through phase 2, the production season, right now. Actually, before we do, let's just have a look at the minis. The minis look fantastic, and we'll talk about them very shortly as well. But this is that phase 2 I wanted to talk about. What we have here is a deck of cards, and this is that core mechanic I was talking about. Now, this deck of cards has resources, has these trouble cards, which are raising your unrest levels. Now, your unrest levels are going to be basically your push your luck element. If you push your unrest too much, then your workers are going to revolt. Now, actually, while we're at it, here's another issue. They talk about in this about whipping your workers and things like that. And basically, I guess they're talking about slavery here. Now, they never mention slavery. They say, look, you know, we're not talking about slaves and stuff. But when you mention that you're whipping the workers, like doesn't feel right to me. Like if you change the rule book to say something like, you know, these workers, you know, they're paid workers and they come in and you're paying them to build this massive, beautiful city for you, no problems at all with that. And you're working them hard, that's fine. But again, you know, if it sort of feels like we're talking about slavery here, then I'm not comfortable with that. Now, I know that's historical and that's fine, but I don't think this is a historical game. Yeah, this is a family-friendly game, and we want a family-friendly theme to go with it. So anyway, that was a side tangent. Okay, back to this. So let's scroll down here. What are these cards we're talking about? So this push your luck mechanic of these cards, what's going to happen is you're going to have these resources. So these resource cards here are going to be stone, going to be wood, and also gold. They're your three main resources. And you're going to be keep going until you collect a resource card. So you're going to see on here that all your cards are face up. So this next person who's going to pick up a card knows they're picking up a resource card, and that's it. They're picking up their card. That's the end of that turn for them. Then it's going to go to the next player, and they're going to keep picking these cards until they get a resource card or they pass. So that's how the game's going to work. You're going to just keep picking cards until you've got the resources you need to build your building that you've placed down, or you're going to get so much unrest that you're going to need to pass. So that's the push your luck mechanic. So here we go. So you've got like your resource cards, your trouble cards, and these are those things pushing your unrest level up. And you've got two other cards, Horus's Choice. Horus's Choice is where you've got two options. You can either pass straight up, or you can take two cards blindly. Now again, those two cards might push your unrest level, you know, too high, might push it to revolt. And that they're the little risks you need to take. The next one, I really like this one. This is the Ninth Plague of Egypt. And what this is, when this card comes out, remember this deck of cards that is all face up, and you're going to be able to see as you go along which one you go on. But like I said, once you start, you have to go until you hit a resource card. So you sort of know where you're going, but you already know that first card. But when you get this Plague of Egypt, what's going to happen is all your cards are going to turn around, so you're now pulling blindly. So now there's even more risk in your push your luck. So look, I love that mechanic. I love this idea of, you know, you're going to be constantly involved in the game, because you're literally going to pull until you get your resource card, the next person's going to go, and it's just going to keep going back and forth until everyone has passed. So look, great way of keeping everyone involved throughout the entire game. There's that rule book. Go have a read for yourself. It's pretty, you know, it's... the information's there, but again, for an English reader, it just doesn't flow like we would normally write a rule book. So again, those little polished things that we expect in board games nowadays just were lacking. Okay, so let's talk about these buildings. So we've talked about you need to put out a building or two to begin with, and that's pretty much like your template for what you want to build. If you collect those resources during that second phase, then you can actually build those buildings. So these are the buildings you can build. The first ones are the small buildings. Now, these are the bread and butter buildings of your city. Now, the first one, warehouse, where you can actually store resources going into the next round. So that's a real nice to have. Master Builder, you need these to be able to build more buildings at a time. So what this game is it's basically, it's a race to build your city. So what's going to happen is every game is going to be a predetermined amount of buildings that you need to build, and it's a race to build those. So it might be a pyramid and five administrative buildings. So everyone knows that's what we need to do to win the game. So how you're going to do that is building up slowly through these sort of little buildings. Now the next three are going to be your resources. So these are going to be how you're going to collect resources to go on top of those resource cards. So it's going to make you get to that goal quicker. So goldsmith, stone cutter, and carpenter, pretty self-explanatory. You're going to get gold, stone, and wood. Now, administrative buildings, these are your medium-sized buildings. Now, these are going to all have interesting different things that are going to happen if you build them in your city. So this one's going to let you turn those trouble cards into wilds, into wild resources, which is a great advantage. This one's going to turn the double unrest cards into single unrest cards. And there's a whole bunch of other things that happen with these administrative buildings, and you can go through these in your own time. And the last one is there's two main buildings, your pyramids, so iconic, I love that, and also the port, so your harbor there. And so what's going to happen is each one of your game endings might be, you know, maybe one harbor and a couple of administrative buildings, or a pyramid and a harbor. Like it's going to be different things which are going to be your end conditions. Okay. Now, here we talk about the videos, again, all in French. If you speak French, then you're going to be loving those videos. What do you get in the game? First things first, reference board. Super important, because when those buildings are on your game board in front of you, you know, at first glance, it's going to be hard to tell what each one of them do. So this is going to show you. It's also going to show you what resources you're going to need to build them. You know, just basic information. I love the fact they got a reference board for each player there. Well, I hope it's for each player. It's actually only one reference board, actually. Oh, God. I wish they brought four of them. Actually, they really need that. It's another thing, I think. One for each player, because something nice and easy for people to see. Four construction sites. There are all your season cards. And this is your obelisk for the standard edition. And there's going to be, yeah, for the standard edition, you're going to get just your, you're just going to get, going to just get these little tokens, which again, nice. I like the artwork. Nothing wrong with that. Not every game has to be massive minis. But in this instance, if you were going to back it, I think you'd be crazy not to go the minis. So here we go. Card dispenser, beautiful. The obelisk again in 3D and all of these buildings. Look at them all there. So if they look anything like that, now these are obviously just renderings. If they come across anything like these, it's going to look incredible. Now, this is my concern. These are only renderings. I'd love to see the final product. Again, makes me feel like this campaign is way too rushed. There we go. Whole bunch of things there. Palaces, temples, beautiful. Now, my next red flag. Now, this is, I hope I don't come across too negative on this, because again, I really do hope that this campaign succeeds, and I really do hope that I actually think about what, you know, what they're doing wrong, what they can do to better fix this campaign and maybe relaunch in the future. That would be my ideal situation. But look, if they stick with it, good on them. So what we have here is 71 euros, which is, yeah, it's under $80 US. Now, $80 US for big box, lots of minis, makes me concerned. That seems way too cheap. Now, the two comparison games I think of are Cleopatra. So Cleopatra, again, massive big box, Egyptian minis, lots of minis, big minis, cost a fortune, but looked incredible on the table. The other comparison is Foundations of Rome. Now, Foundations of Rome, again, lots of minis, and the minis look spot on. They look great. It's a light game comparable to this. This is a light game. Yeah, I think that's a really good comparison, but again, you know, the cost of that was so much more, and because, you know, the quality was there, and this makes me just concerned. Without seeing the production copy of this, what is the quality going to be like? Anyway, everyone who's backing this is backing for the likes. Only 8 people going for standard edition, and look, again, makes sense. I get it. Those 3D minis is what's appealing to people, and a retail version, and so on. Now, a whole bunch of unlocks that haven't unlocked because there's no money yet, but look, some interesting unlocks. You know, I like this storage box. That looks fascinating. And have a look at this down here. Deluxe resources. Now, I highly doubt the resources are going to look that good. There's no way they're going to look that good. But if they do, bloody hell, people will buy a mozza of those resources. They would look brilliant. But again, without the production copy, it's only a render. I'm not happy with that, you know, if I was the one backing those. Now, postage. Very specific prices here in postage. Look, it is what it is. You can see them there. You'll know yourself if that's what you want to back. Now, the other thing to consider is there is no VAT here mentioned. So it's an unknown. I have no idea if there's going to be VAT included or VAT on top. Yeah, again, these are questions that need to be answered by the publisher. And then a whole bunch of why back us. One little thing, another thing to note is on top of all that game you're getting for 71 euros or like $80 US, you also get one of their previous games. It's a little 1-2 player version of their game, and yeah, it's just a little add in there. So that's a nicety. I have no problems with that. And there we go, some of those French reviewers and a couple of French quotes there. And that's the campaign page. So look, what are your thoughts? Was I too harsh on this? Like, look, at the end of the day, I guess I had such high hope for it. It looked like a game I would be interested in. Look like a game that, you know, I think I could get this to the table. I think the family would enjoy playing this. I think it has, you know, has that potential to be a really good, solid game in my collection. But all those red flags to me just made me just not want to back it, and obviously also not recommend it to people as well. So until those things are fixed, I'd love to come back, and I hope in, you know, like a week's time, a lot of these things are rectified and some review copies have gone out and we've got some look at the, you know, the final game. But I don't know, I just have doubt that it's going to happen. So anyway, so that's my thoughts. And like I said, not every game I look at is going to be a positive, glowing review. But look, I hope you can see through all that, that there still could be a really good game for you there. So look, that's it from me. Let me know in the comments below, like again, what your thoughts are. Like and subscribe, all that good stuff. I'm Hoax. This is Board Game Bang. Until next time, laters.